Well, folks, we do truly serve an awesome God, and we give them thanks for the awesome students that we had helping us out with the music this morning. Let's give them a hand once again. Well, good morning, everyone. I am Reverend Sean Colfers, and as always, it is my great privilege to be your pastoral care pastor here at Christ United, where we are continuing to love God, love people, and change the world. Now, folks, we want to welcome you to this incredible day of worship that we're having today for our church-wide celebration. We want to especially welcome our new song folks that are coming over here to the sanctuary today. We love having you worship God with us this morning. And as you can see, it's going to be a really fun day of worship. Now, you'll also, of course, notice our beautiful decorations behind us because we are celebrating VBS. We're giving you a little bit of a taste of what's going to be coming up this week with Vacation Bible School, and so we hope that you will enjoy it. And as we prepare our hearts for worship this morning, folks, in this unified service, let us remember that we worship a creator of unity who calls us into a body of peace through the spirit of community, binding us, his people, through his holy word, his mercy, and his redeeming love. Amen? So come now and let us worship our Lord God Almighty.
Amen. Well, there's no more motions this morning, so you guys can be a little bit relieved. You don't have to wave your hands, but you can raise them if you want to. Why don't you guys stand as you're able, and we are gonna continue worshiping the Lord. Bless the Lord.
Bless the Lord. Sun comes up, it's a new day dawn.
like never before, oh my soul. Sing like never before, oh my soul. I'll worship your holy name. Oh, I'll worship your holy name. Oh, I'll worship your
Yeah.
Celebration Church. You may have a seat this morning.
I invite you to come up at this time. What a wonderful time of worship, and how we are continuing to be incorporated into God's great story of salvation today. It's a great day of celebration. Amen. Brothers and sisters in Christ, through the sacrament of baptism, we are initiated into Christ's holy church. We are incorporated into God's mighty acts of salvation and given new birth through water and the Spirit. All this is God's gift offered to us without price. So Meredith, I ask you, on behalf of the whole church, do you renounce the spiritual forces of wickedness, reject the evil powers of this world, and repent of your sin? If you do, say, I do. Do you accept the freedom and power God gives you to resist evil, injustice, and oppression in whatever forms they present themselves? Do you confess Jesus Christ as your Savior, put your whole trust in His grace, and promise to serve Him as your Lord in union with the church which Christ has opened to people of all ages, nations, and races? The people of God, I ask you, as Christ's body, the church, do you reaffirm both your rejection of sin and your commitment to Christ? If you do, say, we do.
We do.
Will you nurture one another in Christian faith and include these now before you in your care? Would you read with me together? With God's help, we will proclaim the good news and live according to the example of Christ. We will surround Him with a community of love and forgiveness, that He may grow in His trust of God and be found faithful in His service to others. We will pray for Him that He may be a true disciple who walks in the way that leads to life. Father God, I ask that you would pour out your Holy Spirit on these gifts, to bless this gift of water and those who receive it, to wash away their sin and clothe them in righteousness throughout their lives, that dying and being raised with Christ, that they may share in His final victory. Hey, buddy, how are you? How's it going, man? Turn around and see everybody. What name is given this child? Thank you. Nice hair. That's good. Jack Henry Enfinger, I baptize you in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. And all God's people said, amen. Amen. Let's give God a hand of praise. Look, everybody's clapping. These are all the people that said they're going to help to raise you so that you know Jesus. And let's go back to Mama. She's like, I'm going to go over here. Let's pray together. Lord God, we thank you so much for Jack Henry. We thank you for the commitment that you have made through Jesus Christ to give him the offer of salvation. Lord, thank you for this family who has come together to receive the sacrament of baptism, to raise Jack Henry to know you all the days of his life. And Lord, we ask that as a church, we would be faithful to the promise that we have made today. Would you bless us to be a blessing to one another, that we may grow in faith? We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. All right. Thank you all so much.
Let's praise God again for Jack Henry today. And it's been so exciting the last several weeks. Phone's going to work. There we go. It's been so exciting the last several weeks. We've had a baptism almost every single week for as long as I can remember this year, which is so incredible to see that. We're so glad that Jack is a part of that today. At this time, we want to move our hearts and prayers to the Lord, and I'm going to lift up our prayer list to you today. We want to extend our sympathy to Dr. Stephanie Groves and Monica Groves in the death of their father, Dr. Lyle Groves. Also, Mark LaFleur and his family in the death of his mother, Ilsa LaFleur. Also, we have praises today, the baptism that we've already given thanks to God for today with Jack Henry Enfinger. And we have someone joining the church today. Sarah Jane Thompson is going to be joining at the end of this service. And so we rejoice with those celebrations today. Now I want to invite you to turn your eyes to the screen and your hearts to the Lord. Just spend a time, a moment of prayer as you read over these names that are on our prayer list. There are many as Sean comes to prepare us to go to the throne of grace.
Let us bow our heads as we go to the Lord. God of community, enthroned in eternity, crucified and risen Christ, dwelling in heaven and with your people, powerful Holy Spirit, bringing life and truth, we thank you for calling us when we had no hope and for crowning us with salvation as you did for your people Israel. We thank you, Lord. We thank you for enriching our lives with all that is good and for providing for us in times of trial. Make us ever more mindful of the blessings you grant us each day. Deepen our trust in your love and mercy. Increase our thanksgiving by guiding our offerings to help others in need. Father, unite us all in a community of thanksgiving, always glorifying you and lifting others in love to your great care. God of joy, we thank you for all of the children of our church and our community that will be with us this week for VBS. May they feel your love and presence and be filled with your Holy Spirit. And for all of our staff and wonderful volunteers, may you bless us with energy, compassion, and grace to share the good news of Jesus Christ with them through the transformative power of the Holy Spirit. And God of mercy, hear us today as we pray for those that are struggling in mind, body, or spirit, especially for those that are on our prayer list this day. We pray for those with chronic illness, for those who have life-threatening conditions, and for those with inadequate medical care. Bring the healing we need, Lord. And Father, we ask that you would hear us as we pray for all who are hungry. We pray for those who live in regions of drought and famine, for those who can't afford nutritious food, and for the vulnerable who are not adequately fed. Lord, give us the food that is needed. And Father, hear us as we pray for those who grieve this day. We pray for those who mourn a loved one, for those whose communities are no more, and for those who can't imagine a joyful future. Give them comfort to restore hope. And God of the poor and poor in spirit, we pray for your help against all that oppresses, as we look forward to growing your kingdom, which we can begin to live in through the community created by the power of the Holy Spirit and our belief in the resurrected Christ. Father, we humbly lift these prayers before you as we join together now, praying as Jesus taught his disciples. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Well, folks, this brings us to our time of offering, where we continue to share with you different ways that your generosity is helping our missions and ministries here at Christ United to love God, love people, and change the world. And it probably won't surprise you that today we're going to lift before you Vacation Bible School, our children's ministry, because, folks, they have put in an incredible effort this week, as they do every year. We want to thank so much all of our volunteers that are helping with VBS, for all of the children that are going to be coming this week, that they will just be energized and will be able to fill these children's hearts with the Holy Spirit, with the love of Jesus Christ, so that when they go back home and back into their community, that they will share that love of Jesus Christ with others. And folks, it wouldn't happen without all of you. we wouldn't be able to let these children, these hundreds and hundreds of children, know the love of Christ if it wasn't for your generosity. So again, thank you so much for all that you give here at Christ United. And we want to invite you to give once again. You can go to christunited.com/give, or of course, you can give through our text number of 251-551-4483, or you can write a check, mail it in, or drop your offering in one of the offering boxes at the rear of the sanctuary. Again, thank you so much for helping us to love God, love people, and change the world.
Brothers, let us come together, walking in the Spirit.
Before we go any further, let's just give God praise for our amazing musicians today. It was so fun. It was so fun to have both Alanda and Courtney and New Song and Sanctuary folks all working and playing together. It's really awesome. I'm going to put my bottle of water down here by the fire. I hope it doesn't melt. Hope it doesn't knock the rock down there either. Well, today is kind of fun because, you know, Pastor Brian and I, we prepare sermons together every week. And typically, one of us is over there and one of us is over here. And then the next week, we swap places. Well, today, you're going to get both of us. And so, this is what I call a tag team sermon. I'm going to preach until I get in trouble. And then I'm going to get Brian to tag in. And then if he gets in trouble, I'll tag back in later and see how it goes. But today, we're continuing in our series, God's Story, Our Story. The graphic for this series is a little campfire and people that, you know, and it's been so cold this summer, nothing like a campfire, right? But I love that we have a little campfire up here because this story of God, most of the time wasn't read out of a book, but it was told around a fire and it was told around the people for thousands of years. That's how people learn God's story. And so we want to, in that same spirit throughout this series this summer, we're going to be doing that as well. Now let's do a quick review. I think we've got a graphic up on the screen that'll kind of do a quick review of where we've been so far. The first thing that we talked about a few weeks ago was creation. Maybe we don't have a graphic up there. The first thing was creation. And then second was what? What was second? Catastrophe, right? Bad things happen. All right, the third thing that we talked about last week was covenant. All right, and today we're talking about community. Very good. Some of y'all have your passports. You should be able to see that. I invite you to turn with me to Exodus chapter 19, verses 3 through 6. Let's hear God's word for us today. Then Moses went up to God. The Lord called to him from the mountain, saying, "Thus you shall say to the house of Jacob and tell the Israelites, you have seen what I did to the Egyptians and how I bore you on eagle's wings and brought you to myself. Now, therefore, if you obey my voice and keep my covenant, you shall be my treasured possession out of all the peoples. Indeed, the whole earth is mine, but you shall be for me a priestly kingdom and a holy nation. These are the words that you shall speak to the Israelites." This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Let's pray to God together. Lord God, thank you so much for this story. Lord, it is definitely your story, our great God's story. But Lord, thank you, God, that you have seen fit by your grace and mercy so that it can also be our story. Today, help us to envision what it means to be your community, to see your deepest desire for your people to become all that we could be. It's in Christ's name we pray. Amen. One of the things that Pastor Brian and I have in common is that both of us played in the marching band. Both of us played in marching band in high school. I went to Auburn High School. Where did you go to high school?
Hillcrest Christian.
Hillcrest Christian High School, and we both were in our bands there, and then also we both went to college, and Brian went to Southern Miss, to the top, there we go, and I went to Auburn. All right, it was kind of weak.
Southern Miss got you on that one.
Yeah, Southern Miss beat us on that one. So,
and that's about the only thing, right?
That's right.
It's fine.
So we were both in our college marching bands as well. And I know that's probably, it doesn't surprise you because of how cool Brian and I are, and band kids are always known as the coolest kids in school. But I learned a lot about life by being a part of the marching band, especially in my high school marching band. Our high school marching band my freshman year was directed by Dr. Tommy Goff. He had been the band director there for 35 years, and he had a military background. He'd gone to the Army, and he brought that discipline to our band. And I learned so many things about what it was to be a part of a group of people dedicated to one another and dedicated to doing something together on the field to make something amazing. And one of the things that I learned the most from was the rules that they had when it came to our uniforms. I remember as a freshman thinking, what is all the big deal about this? Why does he make such a big deal about us always wearing our uniforms and always being dressed just right? But they were meticulous when it came to our uniforms. They had to be dry cleaned every week, and we had to take them to the dry cleaner. We had to make sure that our shoes were bright white, and if there was even a scuff on them, we would get a demerit on a Friday night, and sometimes they would bring the shoe polish there to make sure they could cover it up. We had these cords that went on both sides around our armpits right there, but they smelled terrible. These cords that went around our armpits, and one of them was right and one of them was left, but no one could tell the difference between the two, especially from the stands. But if you had the right cord on the left side and the left cord on the right side, you got a demerit because everything had to be perfect. And I didn't understand why. And Mr. Goff told us, listen, you're something special. You're not just Rob Couch. You're not just some punk 14-year-old kid in high school. You are a part of the Auburn High School Band, one of the greatest high school bands in the country. When you have that uniform on, you don't just represent you. You represent our band. You represent our community. You represent our school. And so for that reason, we could never had to wear every single piece of our uniform all the time, even our hat. On those very hot 95-degree weather, 100% humidity Friday nights, we would be all decked out from head to toe in our wool uniforms. And over the course of those 4 years, it sunk in. I was part of something special. I was part of something greater than myself. I was part of doing something for the world that I had to do and I got to do with these amazing people on the field every single week. I wonder, do people of the church feel that way about being the church? I think sometimes we do, but sometimes our sense of ourselves is so much less. Sometimes we see ourselves very individualistically and we're only thinking about ourselves and thinking about and watching out for number one instead of understanding that we're a part of a bigger community. And sometimes we forget just how special God's call is on our heart and in our lives. I wonder, do we really believe what God can do in us and through us? When you hear that slogan, you've heard it several times already, love God, love people, and change the world, do you roll your eyes and think, no way, no way in the world could we do that, could we be that? Today we're going to be stepping into the story. And I wonder, did these Israelites know just how special they were? Brian?
You know, when it comes to God's people, they honestly wondered this, and we would have wondered the very same thing, knowing from where God had brought them. I mean, 5 minutes ago, before this scripture, they were just slaves in Egypt, and here they are, hearing God's word. If you go back and look at their story and look at last week where we talked about Abraham, these were Abraham's descendants, and God had said that all of the world would be blessed through them, that they would have land and that they would have these descendants that would be more numerous than the stars in the sky and the sand of the earth. And yet they find themselves enslaved in Egypt. But God raises up the most unlikely in order to do his will. In fact, Abraham, that blessing went from Abraham to his son Isaac and then to Jacob. And Jacob had 12 sons. And of those 12 sons, he had Joseph. And Joseph was his very special favorite son. And all of his brothers knew it. And if you've heard the story before, you realize that they sold Joseph into slavery. And they told their dad, Jacob, that Joseph had been killed by a wild animal. Joseph was sold into slavery, and he was sold over and moved over into Egypt. And so he continued to be faithful to God, and he had this story where he was continuing to be truthful and living out the way in which God had called him to live, even while he was in captivity. And so God continued to bless Joseph, and he blessed him by helping him be able to interpret dreams. And one of the dreams that he interpreted was none other than the Egyptian Pharaoh, the king. And the Egyptian Pharaoh had this dream about 7 years of plenty, but then they would be followed by 7 years of famine. So Joseph, interpreting this dream, helped the Pharaoh to see that there was something special about Joseph. In fact, Pharaoh promoted Joseph to be none other than second in command to Pharaoh. To think about this enslaved young kid that got moved and picked on by his brothers and sent away. Now he is second in command to help the Egyptian people, to actually overcome and enjoy this plenty that they had throughout the 7 years, but also to save up for the next 7 years. And not only did God bless them during those 7 years, the Egyptians, but the Egyptians were actually a blessing, and Joseph was a blessing to the rest of the ancient Near East around them. People from all around came so that they might have food during the middle of that terrible famine. And so did Joseph's brothers. And at first, they didn't recognize him. But God was a blessing through Joseph to the rest of the country and the rest of the area around there that they would come and receive this food. And it was revealed later that Joseph was indeed alive. And Jacob's family moves all the way to Egypt, and they're there. And they grow in number, and it seems like they're a blessing to everyone there. But eventually, Pharaoh after Pharaoh came, and there was one who did not know Joseph, who did not see that his brothers and the descendants of Abraham were truly a blessing. In fact, they saw them as a threat. And so Pharaoh enslaved God's people in Egypt for 400 years. 400 long years of putting them under harsh labor, of continuing to oppress God's people. See, God's people were not in the land that they had been promised. Instead, they were in captivity. And so God raised up one man, an unlikely man, Moses, to lead God's people, to go to Pharaoh and say, "Let my people go." Eventually, God shows all these signs and wonders, and he moves his people and rescues his people out of Egypt and brings them into the wilderness through the Red Sea and brings them to Mount Sinai to receive this covenant, this continuation of this covenant that he had made through Abraham. And he's continuing to show how they're going to be a blessing to the entire world. So how does this group of ragtag, you know, just unlikely people come to be God's treasured possession? Well, check out what it says here in verse 4. God says to Moses, to instruct his people, he says, "You have seen what I did to the Egyptians and how I bore you on eagle's wings and brought you to myself." This is a very important part of what God is going to do here, because God is showing that it's not about what they have done, but instead it's about what God has done in their lives, in their history, and how God has brought them to himself. I love this beautiful imagery that we have here of the mother eagle caring for her young. In fact, if you know a little bit about eagles, the mother eagle will take her young eaglet and push them out of the nest in order to help them to learn to fly. That seems kind of crazy, don't you, to think, oh man, just, you know, kick them out the nest and try to see if they can do what they're supposed to do. But that eagle takes such care. That mother eagle, when it sees its young eaglet in trouble as it's learning to fly, will swoop in when it sees that eaglet in trouble and rescue it and bring it back to the nest safely. See, what God is saying here is God is helping us to see that it's about his grace. It's about his steadfast love. It's not about that these people are super important on the, in and of themselves, that God in his grace has claimed them for himself. And God is the one whose faithfulness has brought them together to be the people that he has called them to be, to do and live the way that God has called them to live. So it's out of God's grace that God calls them and equips them for the ministry, for the mission that they have. Check out what he says in verse 5. It says, "Now therefore, if you obey my voice and keep my covenant, you shall be my treasured possession out of all the peoples." You shall be my treasured possession. Now, if we look back at Exodus and we even look at Genesis, we find that this is not about, they're keeping the covenant. It's not about whether or not they're going to be God's people. They're going to be God's people regardless, but they won't be all that God has created them to be unless they follow through with God's covenant, unless they obey God's commands and keep his covenant. And friends, it's out of God's grace that he has called us to himself. And God has called us to remain faithful to the covenant that he has given each one of us. And it says here that they will become a kingdom of priests. Isn't that beautiful? To think about a whole kingdom that God brings together, a whole people, to be a kingdom of priests. Now, what do priests do? Well, priests represent God to people. That's exactly their mission in the world, that they are to represent God to the people, to live the way that God calls them to live, but they're also to represent people to God. There's this mediating relationship that they have. But could you imagine if an entire kingdom would actually follow through and be the priestly kingdom that God has called them to? Would you imagine an entire nation that is a holy nation, that is set apart for God's good purposes, that responds to God's grace, accepts his calling to be his people in such a way that we make a difference in the world? See, the thing is that we were rescued to reveal God's light. We were rescued to reveal God's light in the world, to the world, and for the world. That if you look over in 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 9, there's this similar language that gets brought up in Peter's letter. Check out what he says. He says, "But you are a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, God's own people." Check out why. It says, "In order that you may proclaim the mighty acts of him who called you out of darkness into his marvelous light." Friends, you are claimed, chosen by God to reveal his light. You were called out of sin. You were saved by grace. You are clothed in Christ's righteousness so that you might proclaim God's mighty acts, to reveal his light in a world that is dwelling in darkness. Friends, you too were rescued. You were rescued to reveal God's light.
Can I get an amen for that? Now, the question we always try to ask at the end of our messages is, how do we do this? How do we put this into practice tomorrow? And there's a couple of things that we want to share with you today. The first thing of how to do this is to love God. In this part of God's story, one of the most important things happens in all of the story. And God gives to Moses and to his people 10 words, 10 commandments by which they should live. These commandments embody the character of God and embody the kinds of things human beings are supposed to do in order to be people of the covenant, in order to be the people who reveal the light to the world. You may not realize this, but the Ten Commandments are kind of grouped. The first handful of commandments have to do with loving God, and the latter ones have to do with loving one another, in relationship with one another. So first of all, love God. Let me just read, and we're actually using kind of a kid's Bible version of this. We knew we might have some kids in here today, but to be honest, I kind of need these as well to kind of get the essence of what these are about. The first commandment is to make God your only God. Worship him only. Number two, don't worship anything except God. Put away those idols. Third, be respectful in using God's name. Don't throw around the precious name of God, but respect it. And then this fourth one here is kind of the pivot point of the commandments. It's the one about the Sabbath. It says, keep the Lord's day special. And it begins to help us shift into this second act of what we need to be doing. And the second thing is to love people. And the rest of the commandments are about our relationships with one another. Honor your parents. Can I get an amen from some parents out there today? Do not kill. Keep your marriage promises. Do not steal. Do not lie, and do not want what others have. Can you imagine a community that lives like that? A community that's loving God like that every single day, and a community that's loving one another like that? A community like that would be like a city on a hill. It would be a lighthouse in a dark world. One of the things I love about our sanctuary is that it is on the top of this hill up here. Now, we get hit by lightning all the time for that reason. That steeple just reaches up there and electrons go right after it. But I love that our church, in its very nature, where it's seated, is like a city on a hill. And the thing I love about the Christ Center is on the front of it, is a lighthouse. That we're beacons of God's light. You know, when you're in the marching band, looking good is really important. But what you do on the field is what really matters. Our band director was fanatical about sounding good. We had to sound and play in tune. We had to hit every note right. We had to memorize all of our music. We had to do it perfectly. And he said, if we could not play the music perfectly on the field, then all we would, if we couldn't play and march at the same time and not play it perfectly, then he would just march us out there and we would stand there and play until we could play it right. We have to make sure that our spacing is right. We make sure that our lines are straight. We have to make sure that everything we do on that field reflects who we are, because we're special, because we're God's people. We're a holy nation, a royal priesthood who have been rescued to reveal God's light to the world. That's who you are, and that's who we want to be. Let's pray. Lord God, thank you so much for your grace that meets us here today. Lord, I confess that too often I haven't been that kind of church. I hadn't been that kind of person. I've had a lower vision of myself, a lower sense of who I could be and what our church could be. Lord, I've believed that maybe my job was just to kind of make it through life, do my very best. But Lord, you've rescued me to reveal your light. Lord, help us to do that. Help us to be that city on a hill. Help us to be that lighthouse in a dark world, a beacon of hope, revealing God's light to a dark world. As we prepare our hearts for this song of response, I just want to give an opportunity for anybody in the room to say yes to that, to say yes to Jesus, to say yes to community, to say yes to being God's special chosen people, chosen not to be great, but chosen to be great for God, to reveal God's light to the world. It's in the powerful name of Jesus we pray, and God's people said, amen.
Amen. Amen. Why don't you stand with us as you're able?
Peace is mine, leading on the
We are so excited to welcome Sarah Jane Thompson to be a member of our church today. Sarah Jane is originally from Macon, but is a graduate student at South Alabama, and she's been attending here for the last couple of years, and so we're so glad to have her here with us. So I'm going to ask her the vows of membership. Do you profess Jesus Christ as your Savior and Lord and put your whole trust in His grace? Will you promise to support this church with your prayers, your presence, your gifts, your service, and your witness? Let's praise God for that. I'm going to have Sarah Jane just kind of hang out with me out there by the Lego table. And when you go out today, there are some really big Legos. I think they're actually Duplo blocks, to be official. But grab one of those and put it somewhere visible in your car, your dashboard, maybe where you brush your teeth. And every time you see it this week, I want you to pray for Vacation Bible School. On the back of your bulletin, you can take that with us to remind you of what we're talking about this week. And there's also some cards out there that you could take and invite a friend, or you can just take that to remind, to remember to pray for that as well. I'm going to ask Brian to give our benediction.
We also have Vacation Bible School snacks out there, refreshments. Everybody, can I get an amen?
Amen.
So now, as you go, know that you have been called, you've been chosen by God to reveal His light to the world. So go, go in peace to love God, love people, and change the world. Amen.
Amen.
And God will raise you up on eagle's wings, bear you on the breath of dawn, make you to shine like the sun, and hold you in the palm of His hand.
I know you don't need anything else on your plate.